Hi guys, just bringing you to this any news article about bird study. I put a link to it, and it's basically done by a series of authors, and all the links and information is actually put onto this page. And I'm going to put this link up again. But it's saying basically that bird populations can suffer sort of from low dose radiation levels of 0.05 microsieverts per hour, and basically the level that we're getting in the UK has been quite high. So you know, we've been getting sort of averages of 0.12, 0.13, peaking up to 0.16, 0.17. We've had incidents where it goes up to 0.22 microsieverts per hour for a long period of time, you know, half an hour or so. So we've had contamination issues, and they've also been connected to the pollution issues that The Guardian were talking about as well, I believe. So basically the sort of range we should have in London is point, and that's with a just generally, is 0.03 to 0.15 microsieverts per hour, with you know, sort of hits and 0.02, with averages around 0.05, 0.04, 0.06. You know, we should be having averages around there, but we're kind of double that at the moment. And for the first time ever, I've managed to get a range, which I'm going to connect to this video. So basically, you're going to see one that I did at night, where it got down to 0.06, and that was the first time I saw that. And then when I woke up this morning, I did another one, and I got down to 0.06 again. So we do have a 0.06 to 0.15 range in the UK, which is, although the average is the same, near enough. I mean, I'd say the average maybe is down at 0.10, to be quite honest, 0.11, but it moves up and down during the day. You know, if you do a daily average or an hourly average, you would have a different thing. But that's the sort of area we're at the moment, which is good. But 0.06, fantastic. That's really good news. And it also proves, and I've got it on video now, that that we should have that sort of range, although we're getting much higher, you know, more of the higher end of the range, and those 0.06 aren't coming in very regularly, you know, but they have appeared, and I did manage to catch them on the video, and they are certainly worth posting up. It does mean, though, that after all this European contamination, that our background radiation seems to have gone up by 0.03 or maybe even 0.04, but we're not getting under 0.06 due to the weather, the high pressure and low pressure zones that have been affecting mainland Europe and the UK and what have you. So with all this happening, we've ended up with a higher background radiation as well, so that's another reason to post this up. And I'm going to try and dig up out of the archives of any news, the radiation monitoring forum, or maybe somewhere on the thread, some of the early posts I put up about the kind of lower end measurements I was getting. One other thing, we had a few rain showers, and one actually I did get a higher reading, but afterwards I thought it was just in the wind. It went up to 0.20, but I think the rain has started easing off, and then the rads mounted, so that was probably in the air. I was a bit excited at the time. I thought I'd caught a radon washout, but unfortunately not. It was a very short rise to 0.20. It didn't last too long, and then we got back to a sort of 0.09 to, which I've had most of the time, is 0.09 to 0.17, 0.18 microsieverts per hour. But last night and this morning, big drop. So you know, here I am Sunday morning, and I'm sucking up some fresh air, sometimes down to 0.06 microsievert. So, and that's got to be good for everyone in London, and I'm glad for everyone for that, because we certainly needed a little bit of a break from this high dosage that I believe we've been getting. I think it's a health issue. We've been breathing it in mainly, not from the the amount of radiation, but damage sort of particulates and gases that we've been sucking up while we've been sleeping, whether they're radon or cesium or iodine, they're not good for us. All right, okay, so I'll put these links up, I'll add these other bits, and I shall stop talking.
The car crunches gravel, and the wind licks at you. This dark spell you're under, as you're dumbstruck by the gate. It hurts every muscle just to walk back to the house. Now this home that you both made, it looks haunted from the yard. You can hear those distant bells, and you know they'll never leave. It's like your church is crying out, like the wolf calls to a young.
I used to hear a boring old doctor talking about nuclear war, but they wanted to see Sellafield and Lily Tomlin. And, you know, after a while, people started to say, well, nuclear was bad for our health. And then I was even asked to address the annual Morticians Association. And I said, well, what do you want me to talk to you about? They said, well, we don't want to have to embalm radioactive bodies. And I said, don't worry, you'll be one yourself. So it got to be really rather ridiculous. But in 5 years, we, the medical profession, because of our extraordinary credibility, as I always said, every politician has a doctor. 80% of Americans were opposed to nuclear war. 80%. Now that's the second American Revolution. It was peaceful, sagacious, and Gandhian, and all done through education. And that led, and I met with Reagan in the White House and held his hand for about an hour and a quarter, reassuring him because he didn't know anything. Yeah, I think he was a bit brighter than W. I also diagnosed he had impending Alzheimer's, which he did. But apart from that, I think I did actually influence him, because he started to say thereafter, nuclear war must never be fought and can never be won. And he started working with Gorbachev. And we, the physicians, led the movement to end the Cold War. And we need to credit ourselves with that. That was very, very significant. But after that, we got in George I, who, he was quite good. He unilaterally removed a few tactical nuclear weapons in Europe to help Gorbachev in what he was doing in Russia. But then we got Clinton. And I really resent Bill Clinton, William Jefferson Clinton, because we handed to him on a silver platter the ability to abolish nuclear weapons. And there had been a precedent, because Reagan and Gorbachev met in Reykjavik over a weekend and almost agreed to abolish nuclear weapons. I mean, it was the most extraordinary situation. And it failed because Reagan was attached to Star Wars. You know, there was this yellow plastic shield over America, and the weapons would come in and go boink, 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 and bounce off. It would never work. Was Teller's idea, and Teller was mad. Gorbachev knew it would never work, but both men were obstinate, and they came out having almost agreed to abolish nuclear weapons, and they failed. So there's a precedent. And Clinton could have drawn up a document to abolish nuclear weapons in 5 years, and you must know that of the 23,000 H-bombs in the world today, Russia and America own 97%. People go on and on about Iran, which does not have nuclear weapons, and all the intelligence agencies in America say there's no evidence they have any or intend to build any. And so that's called displacement activity. If you put rats in a cage and threaten them with a lethal situation, they run away and do something irrelevant to that which threatens them. The real rogue nations and the axis of evil are Russia and America, holding the world at nuclear ransom, ready to blow the world up tonight. And we get very close to within seconds of them pressing a button because the computer makes a mistake, or the satellites are set off by a flock of geese or a rising moon thinking America's under attack, or they mistake a weather satellite going up in Norway for an attack on Moscow, and Yeltsin got to within 10 seconds of pressing the button in 95. I don't know how we're still here. And the Chinese are hacking into the early warning system as we speak. And so are young kids, because it's all computerized, for God's sake. And I'll talk about where you sit here today in terms of nuclear weapons, but it's what Kennedy said. Our life hangs on a silken thread, the twisting sword of Damocles over our heads every second of every day. And by God, we ignore it. Therefore, we're mentally sick.
And when I first came in 78,
and when people are suicidal, we hospitalize them because they're sick. They need help.
I remember when I first came to America in 1965, I went through immigration. They said to me, "Are you a communist?" I didn't even really know what a communist was, you know. And then so this was this sort of ethic. And I said, "What, you'd rather be blown up in a nuclear war?" Yeah. I said, "Well, what about the pygmies in Africa? They'll die too." And people said, "Yeah, well, they don't want to be communist either." So I thought, this is sort of psychotic. So then I mobilized with others, 23,000 doctors, and we started describing the medical effects of nuclear war, including a wonderful symposium in LA organized by the Saxons, and another wonderful one in Seattle organized by Judy Lipton, and people were actually scalping tickets at the door. It was so popular.